Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome here to the Manitoba Legislature. Most of you know in the room, my name is Kelvin Goertzen, and I'm here to respond today on behalf of government to the three Auditor General reports that were released this morning. I'm joined to my right by the Honorable William Burnett, who is the former Justice on the Manitoba Court of King's Bench, an Associate Chief Judge of that court, and Justice on the Manitoba Court of Appeal. Did I get that right, Bill?
You've got it right.
Okay. And also to my left by Kimberley Gilson, who's an attorney based in Winnipeg and also practices law in northern Manitoba and Nunavut, and she has extensive experience with tribunals, commissions, and investigations of complaints. I believe that both of their bios have been made available to you, and the reason of their for their attendance will become evident as we go along. As mentioned, I'll be responding to the reports on behalf of government today, and I will do so in two capacities. One is in my role as government house leader, as these reports are produced by an independent office of the Manitoba Legislature that reports to the Legislative Assembly as a whole and not to government directly. So the Auditor General provides the reports to, I believe, to the Speaker and then indirectly then to the Assembly. And also in my role as Manitoba's Minister of Justice, as some of the issues will touch on legal matters. I'll be addressing the three reports in sequence, and following my remarks, I'd be happy to take questions on any of them. The first report that I want to speak to pertains to the provision of addictions treatment services in Manitoba, and this is a priority area of our government. I suspect that every Manitoban has in some way been touched by addiction in their life. My own family has, and I know its devastation. Our government has demonstrated its determination to improve outcomes for those dealing with addiction by the establishment of the new Mental Health and Community Wellness Department and the launch of its five-year plan, A Pathway to Mental Health and Community Wellness, A Roadmap for Manitoba. As you may know, if you've looked at the Auditor General's report already, and I know that they just were released this morning, the report was conducted from June 2021 to June of 2022. So this time frame actually coincides with the creation of the department and the launch of the five-year roadmap. Incidentally, the roadmap identifies many of the same concerns that the audit and the Auditor General found. So in many ways, the roadmap is a real-time response to the auditor's findings with significant progress already being made. In fact, I'm advised by department officials that already all of the 15 audit recommendations are either partially or fully being addressed. I want to highlight some of the structural changes and key investments that we as a government have made to enhance the quality and accessibility of addiction services and improve accountability. These include developing system standards, developing an accountability framework, including targets for improving services, developing an upcoming, and the launch will be upcoming, of a navigation portal to enhance services and service direction. And also importantly, by introducing Bill 33 to license treatment facilities. This was cited in the Auditor General's report, the need to ensure standards so that those entities which are delivering addictions treatment can be measured against those standards. We believe this is important, and that is what Bill 33 was intended to do. I don't need to remind all of you, but some of you may not know that that bill was introduced in the spring, and the official opposition of the legislature chose to hold that bill over to the fall, which in an election year, because the House will dissolve before an election, has the effect of killing that legislation. So a very important part of what the Auditor General has recommended in terms of standards when it comes to treatment facilities was on the runway, but wasn't able to take off as a result of decisions by opposition parties in the legislature. But I'm hopeful that in the future that bill will get passed. As well, since the auditor's investigation concluded, $8.7 million has been invested which have opened about 1,650 treatment spaces throughout the province to ensure that regardless of their financial situations, Manitobans have the opportunity to get the treatment that they need to restore their lives. I want to be clear that we're very proud of our comprehensive work we are doing together with our service delivery partners and the historic investments we're making as a government to support treatment and long-term recovery of people who are dealing with addictions from substance use. We've made progress in recent years and will continue these efforts, but we know there is more work to do. Until every Manitoban who is dealing with an addiction is able to get the support they need in the time that they need it, that work is not done. I do want to, on behalf of the department, share a caution on applying the audit findings to the addictions treatment system as a whole. The audit scope included service delivery by Shared Health, Prairie Mountain Health, the WRHA, and Northern Health Authority, but the audit did not cover services in the Interlake, Eastern RHA, Southern Health, the public-funded community agencies, private providers, federal government, or First Nations communities. As such, because of the more narrow scope of the investigation, caution should be exercised in making an interpretation on entities that were not part of the scope of the audit. Now I'll speak to the Auditor General's report on efficiency of our courts. As Minister of Justice, I understand and I understand our duty to deliver timely access to justice within our justice system. Of course, this is challenging, particularly in the northern communities of Manitoba. Nonetheless, I can assure you that Manitoba Justice is already taking steps to address many of the recommendations that are outlined in the auditor's report. Since the spring of 2023, so since this spring, we began implementing the integrated case management program, which will modernize the courts and reduce the paper-based process. It is a historically paper-based process, and the integrated case management system will be significant in reforming that. It's a very big but a very important project. Additionally, 37 virtual courtrooms are currently in operation, including in communities of Thompson, Dauphin, the Paw, and Flin Flon. There will be and there will continue to be an increased use of technology as we try to narrow the gap of justice in a broad province like Manitoba. These technology projects are led by the Justice Technology Committee. We're making good progress on many of them. We're also tapping into new technology, developing partnerships. Yesterday, many of you may have heard that we announced $100,000 of support to MKO for the purchase of 9 business model Starlink systems. Starlink will connect 9 remote First Nations communities and the MKO Youth Healing Lodge with high-speed internet access. I particularly want to thank my friend Chief Grand Chief Garrison Satie for his initiative and his support, and frankly his idea in bringing this to his communities and in helping us bring justice and services and other things to those communities through this connectivity. Not only will it provide secure internet access to facilitate court appearances, a satellite-based connection will also enable residents living in the north to connect to online training, education, victim services, which is very important, and other programming. Of course, there were also recommendations and criticism regarding staffing and the resourcing of staffing. And I recognize that finding adequate staff, frankly, in all parts of society these days is a challenge, and it's a particular challenge in northern Manitoba. But we are committed to aggressive recruitment, innovative solutions, and working with partnerships to improve the ability to deliver justice with more people in the north and using greater technology. Without doubt, the pandemic impacted some timelines for our progress. But the pandemic also did something else. It proved to our court system that it could be flexible, a court system that is rooted in history. It proved that it could do things differently, and we need to build upon that momentum to continue to grow that adaptability and flexibility. And now I'd like to address the portion of the auditor's response today, the report on the PPCO, the Protections and Persons in Care Office. Since its creation nearly 22 years ago, the Protections and Persons in Care Office, the PPCO, has been tasked to investigate and act upon allegations of abuse against vulnerable Manitobans. This includes Manitobans who are living in personal care homes, hospitals, and in other facilities. There are few things more important in a society than protection of vulnerable people. Today's Auditor General report revealed issues that are rooted in how the PPCO was originally structured, in how policies and definitions were interpreted, and in the mismanagement of independent and individual investigations. In short, there were problems with leadership, with investigations, and with the legislation that govern how these work. The report examines some of these challenges dating back nearly 15 years ago. To be clear, what the report revealed, specifically as it relates to abuse of elderly, is sickening and repulsive. The revelation that investigators were pressured to change the findings of their investigations by leadership at the PPCO is very, very troubling. And while the report does not indicate how pervasive these situations were over the two decades that the PPCO has been in existence, not a single one is acceptable. Not a single one. When it was created in 2001, the PPCO's role was to review allegations of abuse and neglect reported to them, to review and investigate where appropriate, and then to make recommendations to the healthcare facilities to ensure that these didn't happen again. But just as importantly, it was to instill trust. Trust, obviously, of those who it relied upon, vulnerable Manitobans, but also trust for their families who had placed or supported individuals in an institution. To be clear, there's no doubt that many of the people over the last two decades who have worked in the PPCO have carried out their duties with caring and with professionalism. This would be true for the vast majority of those working with vulnerable individuals in Manitoba. But it is also clear to our government that it will be difficult for Manitobans to regain the trust in a structure that has existed for more than 20 years that was designed to protect vulnerable Manitobans. While the Department of Health has indicated, and you know, that it is fully accepting the recommendations of the auditor, the government believes that we need to go further than the recommendations made by the auditor to restore the trust of Manitobans who rely on this service. As a result, as it relates to this specific report, I'm announcing the following on behalf of the Manitoba government. Following a time of transition and legislative requirements, the PPCO will be disbanded. It will no longer exist. It will be replaced by an independent office of persons in care. The independent office will have full powers of investigation and reporting as it relates to allegations of mistreatment or abuse of those in care. The office will report to the Legislative Assembly of Manitoba, meaning that it will report to all elected officials in the Assembly. And it will be funded through the appropriations of the Legislative Assembly Management Commission, which is an all-party commission. It will be subject to questioning by all members of the Manitoba Legislature through a public committee. We expect that this work will also necessarily include the consideration of the Adult Abuse Registry system, as these mechanisms are closely tied together. These are the first substantial changes in over 20 years in this area, and it must be done right. As a result, Manitoba will be appointing a special commissioner to provide advice and direction on the legislation, resourcing, and powers needed to create the independent office with its investigative responsibilities. I'm grateful, as I mentioned earlier, to former Justice Burnett for agreeing to take on this role of Special Commissioner to guide in the creation of this new independent office of the Manitoba Legislature. As this is an independent office, Mr. Burnett, I'm sure, will undertake consultation with opposition parties, independent members, and the Speaker of the Legislative Assembly. As Minister of Justice, I've directed Legislative Council in the Department of Justice to make this a top priority to ensure that the legislation is able to be introduced as soon as possible. As well, we'll be launching an investigation into the past files that have been handled by the PPCO. The Auditor General's report, while it examined work done over many years in two different governments, looked at a relatively narrow number of cases. The review will be a deeper examination led by a special counsel, Kim Gilson, who will work to develop the scope of the review and the details. She'll be empowered to determine if these are allegations related to staff and whether they need to be further investigated, other allegations that need to be further investigated for review, and any issues that need to be referred to law enforcement for further review. As mentioned, the creation of the independent office requires both planning and legislation. While there have been changes at the leadership of PPCO, as noted in the Auditor General's report, during the time that it continues to operate in the transition period, Mrs. Gilson will provide oversight and support to the PPCO. In addition, I'm announcing government has authorized an initial support of $2 million over the next 2 years to facilitate the work of the Special Commissioner to establish an independent office, the investigation into the past files, and for the ongoing work to catch up on the backlog investigations. It's my understanding from the Department of Health that they anticipate that the backlog investigations will be cleared by March of next year or sooner. Additional resources will be made available as necessary. Again, these changes are significant and will take time, but I want to provide some assurances on the changes that have happened regarding the PPCO since the Auditor General's investigation began. First, there have been leadership changes made at the PPCO. As well, more staff have been added to deal with the backlogs, and more resources are being provided. Additionally, legislative changes to the definition of abuse, one of the challenges noted, have been passed in the legislature. As well, a dedicated response line and email are being established to address questions Manitobans might have about an allegation that they have reported or that they want follow-up on. The dedicated phone number is 204-788-6366, and an email has been established as well, protection@gov.mb.ca. Phone number 204-788-6366, email protection@gov.mb.ca. These steps go significantly further than what were recommended by the auditor, but we believe that they are important. They're important to restore trust. They're important to ensure that this situation doesn't happen again. Ultimately, we do think this is an important day and an important step in addressing the safety for vulnerable Manitobans and those who are in care and restoring the trust for their families. However, we also know that some of the failings outlined in today's report, dating back 15 years, will cause concerns. To residents, family members, caregivers, we are deeply regretful for the shortcomings of the PPCO and how they affected them and their families, and we are taking decisive action to make sure that they do not happen again. In conclusion, I'd like to, on behalf of both the Legislative Assembly and the Government of Manitoba, acknowledge the work of the auditor and their staff in producing today's three reports. In each of the areas that were examined, many of the concerns raised have been addressed, but in others, there is much more work to do, and we are committed as a government to doing this important work.